Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
One of the real stars in the adult industry today, Elizabeth Bentley. You tell me, you do a great scene down here maybe in Miami of the Reality Kings, and what do you do after that?
Honestly, I go home and pass out. I'm so f***ing tired. Ugh, darn it, I swore.
That's okay. So you're really exhausted. Even if it's one guy, I mean, I'm not talking about three, four, five guys, but one-on-one, one guy afterwards, you're that exhausted?
After a hand job, I'm exhausted.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Morning at 7 o'clock, and we'll get right to it because you do have John Montone from 1010 Winds calling in about 15 minutes. The latest with CC Sabathia now in rehab for the Yanks, and a story that emanates from Long Island that really ends up in Chelsea, which I do want to get Liz's opinion on. She is world-renowned relationship expert, sex therapist, very popular on this program each and every Tuesday morning. It's our dear friend, the great Liz Mandel. Good morning, Liz. How are you?
Good morning. I'm great. How are you?
Doing well. Thank you. Before we get to some of the relationship questions and the sex questions that people love here on Tuesday mornings, I know you're very familiar with the story about the 38-year-old lady, very successful and wealthy dermatologist out of Long Island, that OD'd. They found her dead Sunday morning, her panties in her pocketbook as she was topless, laying dead in a Chelsea apartment on Sunday morning. As a family therapist, she's got three kids. I believe the ages are 1, 5, and 7, and a very successful and handsome husband. How do you deal with that story?
I mean, look, New York City is an adult playground. It is a very dangerous place for people who need outlets because there's so much money floating around this city. It's just unbelievable, and people are so seduced by money and power. And, you know, there's a lot of people that they make decisions to settle down and get married and have kids before they're really ready, you know, to let go of their party lifestyles. I mean, crazy things go on in New York. Can I tell you one story about when I first moved here?
Sure.
Okay.
By the way, I've had a long history publicized in New York, so I'm well aware of some of the stuff that goes on. So whatever you tell me is not going to shock and or surprise me, but I'm interested to hear it anyway.
Yeah, I mean, when I moved to New York, it was a total culture shock. I moved here from Philadelphia. You know, it's like small town city life, but it was nothing compared to New York City. So when I first moved here, I was looking for friends, and I was going on, you know, like meetup.com websites to find friends. And I joined this group, you know, New Girlfriends in the City, so I could find women to hang out with. So I met this model, and she was, 8 years younger than me, and we would go to clubs together. She got into all the clubs, you know, we would just cut right in line. One time we went to a club and, you know, we would party all weekend, Friday, Saturday night until
So when you say party, you were like blowing lines and everything. You were a bad girl, weren't you?
I didn't do cocaine, but But I would drink a lot, and I don't really handle alcohol well. So, you know, I throw up the next day. I mean, it was not good. So this was a Saturday night. We went to a club because, you know, we forced ourselves out. We were really bored. And in New York, you know, no one goes out really before midnight. Midnight in New York is like, you know, 9 p.m.
Right, every place else. Sure.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, to stay out until 4, 5, 6 in the morning is like leaving.
Standard. It's standard. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So we went to a club and we decided that we weren't going to drink because we were so hungover from the night before. So we're circling around the club trying to find, you know, people to talk to. And all of a sudden we run into this Colombian guy. Now, he was like a kid. I mean, this guy was like, he looked like he was 13 years old. And the next thing I knew, he was offering us cocaine, and he gave us a bag of what looked like cocaine after he said, well, you don't have to pay me. You can just make out with me. So my friend made out with him for, you know, a couple minutes just right there at the club. And then we went into the bathroom, and, you know, this was the first time that I was going to try cocaine. And my friend had done cocaine many times, and it turned out to not be cocaine. I think it was baking soda. I mean, so, you know, and we would snort it when we would flush the toilets so people wouldn't hear us, and everyone else was doing that too. So this is just like one example of what happens in New York City. There are lounges in New York City that have like a $10,000 cover charge. Yeah. I mean, there's so much money floating around this city. It's unbelievable. And, you know, I was working with a couple where the wife was cheating on Ashley Madison, and she had, a son a couple years old with a man who was from another country, which is very common that people get married here and you know, the foreigners get married to people here for the green cards. So, you know, they moved out from the city to Hoboken, and they had, you know, a nice family life. So then the wife starts cheating on Ashley Madison, and the husband sees, you know, messages, you know, from her talking with this guy, and this old, much older man is taking her, and she was also in her, like, you know, mid-late 30s. This older man was taking her to this restaurant, Per Se, which is like $1,000, you know, for a meal, and that doesn't even include alcohol. So, you know, there are just crazy things that go on in this city, and you can really get caught up in, you know, the nightlife, in the money. It's all very seductive. And, you know, for me, like, I went out with this girl, you know, to clubs and stuff for 8 months, and I got totally burnt out. And then, you know, she and I eventually, you know, hung out less and less because I just couldn't keep up with the lifestyle. And I, you know, had to take myself and my career seriously.
Right. And then that's where you said goodbye to her. Well, one of the things you wanted to talk about today, which is interesting because of the story, this lady from Long Island is, you know, here she is. She's a parent. She's got three kids, and she's still living this kind of double life. Right, Liz? I mean, she's a dermatologist by day. She's a member of the country club in Manhasset. Everybody loved her. She was supposedly a great tennis player, too. I mean, she was Miss Suburbia, and then she would sneak away on the weekends with her friends and drink and do cocaine. And who knows what else she would do. And that brings us to the next question, one of the three topics you wanted to cover today, which is how parenthood changes a marriage on so many levels, yes?
Yes. Well, you know, I mean, the decision to have kids is a difficult one. Sometimes people know that they want to have kids. Sometimes they're not sure. Sometimes they don't want to have kids. Not everyone who has children wants children. So I'm not saying that this woman didn't want kids, but she obviously, you know, didn't really understand the demands of parenthood and couldn't tolerate the stress involved in it to the point where she needed an outlet to, you know, do drugs and party. And look, in a family like this, a postcard family, it's always these postcard families that have the trouble going on, you know, behind the scenes. It would be no surprise if her husband was also having affairs. You know, she was having an affair with some producer, and then she was, you know, with this other guy who was a drug dealer, who, you know, who's that was the apartment building she was found in, of this drug dealer. You know, people get so caught up in what they don't have that, you know, they will make choices that aren't really, you know, conducive to the lifestyle that they're leading. So it's common for people to maintain these double lives because they don't have an adequate outlet. And, you know, she put up this front like she's, you know, Miss Suburbia, but she obviously couldn't handle the demands of parenthood. And you know, what parenthood does to marriages is it pulls parents apart. That's what it does. People think, oh, having kids will bring couples together. Yes, in a sense, it forces, you know, couples to figure out how to co-parent effectively, but there's another human being that gets in between the couple. The sex life goes down. You know, people, they relate less on the levels that they used to, and now they're only talking about their kids, and they can lose a lot of their relationship that they had and put all the emphasis on their roles as parents.
One of the things you also wanted to talk about today was in terms of cheating, because, and we don't know if this girl was having an affair with that HBO producer or not. I mean, again, it doesn't look good. Panties inside her pocketbook, up all night doing coke and drinking till 8:30 in the morning. She had done this many, many times, renting hotel rooms all over town. So it doesn't look good for her. But when you talk about parents, when you become a parent, how the sex goes down. And you've often said in this program that when sex goes down, that's one of the reasons, if not the main reason, why people end up cheating. But in the end, is it fair to say on the way out here, Liz, that men and women cheat for different reasons?
Generally, no. Women will cheat, and it will usually start out as an emotional affair, where they talk to, you know, a man and they complain about their marriage, and then eventually they end up sleeping with the guy. Men, on the other hand, may jump right into the sex, but if someone is sexually unfulfilled in their marriage, whether it's the wife or the husband, that is generally the main reason why people will cheat.
That is it the main reason by a long stretch? It's not even close?
This is the main reason why people have affairs. They're not feeling sexually satisfied in their marriages.
So then let me ask you this. If, in fact, there's an issue in the marriage, or whatever it is, or even not even a marriage, your boyfriend and girlfriend, there's a major issue, you cannot seem to get past it, and inevitably you're going to have to break up. You're going to have to part ways and go your different directions. What is the best way? Liz Mandel, what is the best way to do that?
Well, you have to have a discussion about it in person. I mean, you hear about these stories where people break up over text messages or social media, which is, you know, totally disrespectful. But you want to, you know, make the boundaries very clear in terms of moving forward, what things are going to look like, you know, whether you want to continue talking or seeing each other, because things can get very sticky. You know, people break up and then they may, you know, have these liaisons together, you know, every month or so. It's hard to really close that door if you have had, you know, that serious of a relationship or not. So you want to make it clear what the relationship will look like moving forward. And you also want to talk about the positive aspects of the relationship. You don't want to make it totally negative. And you want to thank the person for their time. I mean, this is a way for someone to maintain their integrity and not cause, you know, a lot of emotional damage to the other person and to themselves, because inevitably what happens is people do this role reversal where they recreate the dynamic of their last relationship, but they become their partner. So that's what happens when people don't break up the right way. If someone's in a relationship and the other person cheats and then they break up, and the next relationship, that person is more likely to be the cheater.
Interesting. Okay, so for people that want to get some more of this, they want to talk to Liz Mandel, maybe meet you down at your offices, Liz, in Manhattan, talk to you on Twitter. You're a great Twitter follower. Where can people get more of Liz Mandel? How do they do that?
They can find me on ManhattanFamilyTherapy.com.
And then on Twitter, you have a bunch of different Twitter addresses. Which one do you want? Or give them all right here. Why not? Give them all.
Elizabeth Therapy. It's one word. The TH is shared, and it's Elizabeth with an S. And Love Doc NYC.
Love Doc NYC. And you do have a tendency, a habit of tweeting about your own personal life. It may be something going on a Saturday night or a Sunday morning. And you're very honest and upfront about all of that, aren't you?
I'm very honest. I try to be relatable. You know, people, they don't want to go, you know, open up about their sex life
True.
To someone who they think won't even understand. You know, they're like 200 years old and, you know, they have cobwebs down there and they don't even know what's relevant anymore.
Well, as always, it was a titillating 15 minutes. Very, 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 very good educational and fun stuff. And once again, you knocked it out of the park, Liz Mandel, as you do each and every Tuesday. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.
You too. The great Liz Mandel. We'll take a quick 30-second break. When we get back, it is the most listened to and the best news station really in the history of this country. And he's the best reporter ever. He knows that. I know that. My dear friend John Montone on a couple of stories breaking out of New York City right after this. Yesterday. Well, let's get right to it. Live in New York City, of course, you know when you want news, there's only one place to go. The most listened to news station anywhere.
All news, all the time. This is 1010 Wins.
Yes.
You give us 22 minutes, we'll give you the word.
And we'll give you John Montone, my favorite reporter. Hey, John, how many years you been with 1010 Wins?
Going back to when I had full thick black hair, and that's all I will say about that.
It's been a couple of years. Okay. Hey,
yes.
Let me start with a story you covered yesterday that has really bothered me, and that is this woman, 38 years old, a very successful Manhasset dermatologist with three beautiful kids and a husband, found dead from an overdose in a Chelsea apartment on Sunday morning. What is the latest there? And I'd imagine the whole city is upset over that story, yes?
Yeah, and I think you're right. I mean, even as a reporter, when you come in and you get your story and you're looking down, you know, the police sheet on it, and it some of them bother you more than others. And this certainly did. Kirsten Cervini was a very successful dermatologist with a husband who was a doctor. They lived out in Long Island. She had three beautiful children. She was physically beautiful and very intelligent. And apparently she enjoyed cocaine. And that's what at least the preliminary findings are, that after a night out on the town with her girlfriends Saturday night, she left with a fellow who's a producer for HBO. They went to an apartment allegedly rented out by a drug dealer. They scored some cocaine. They did the cocaine, and it killed her. That's preliminary. Early on, they thought maybe she was murdered. She did have a bruise on her neck when they found her, the doctor, dead in the doorway, as everyone was saying yesterday. But apparently it was the drugs.
Yeah, no, see, supposedly, what I've read, allegedly, those bruises on her neck now, we find out, not from strangulation or a murder, but from a prior surgery she had. And they said, in fact, that she may have even upped her cocaine intake after that surgery to numb the pain.
Yeah, yeah, and that's possible. You know, you don't. It's very hard. You know, you get on the air and you get preliminary information from sources that have spoken to newspapers, that have spoken to the police, and you read that she did have an appetite for cocaine, and that she mixed it with booze. She was out all night drinking with her friends, and that love of the nightlife may have cost her life.
Yeah, and again, allegedly, she had been to that apartment before. It was not her first time.
Right. Somebody there had recognized her, that she had been there before. The fellow who rented the apartment is an ex-con who is allegedly still dealing dope. And so it just looks like she just made a fatal mistake.
Mm. Well, it looked like really two lives, the beautiful country club and the family and all that on Long Island, and then the seedy after-hours drugs at night. I mean, really.
Yeah, the deep, dark secret. And look, you know, cocaine is probably the drug of choice among certain hard-driven, very ambitious people.
True.
And that was apparently her demon.
Yeah, that's one story about addiction. She had that addiction. The other story right now is surfacing in New York, John, about addiction. Alcohol addiction centers around New York Yankees starter CeCe Sabathia. And I got to tell you, John, as an addict, I'm in recovery. I have very little patience for people who want to bash even that lady. I know she had three kids, but certainly Sabathia. I can't believe the amount of moronic Yankee fans that are on Facebook that are crushing CC because he's going to rehab the night of the playoffs.
Right.
Really?
He won't wait. He won't wait.
Come on.
One of the quotes this morning was that this weekend bender in Baltimore, his drinking got so bad that he was actually afraid for his life. When you get to that point, baseball is wonderful. You know, it's my favorite sport, but it is not life. And, you know, CC did the right thing. His teammates are behind him. And but who knew? I mean, there were a couple of isolated incidents. He got a little agitated at the airport in Newark last Christmas, had to be restrained, then again up in Toronto. But, you know, you don't put that together and think, the guy must be an alcoholic.
And again, like you said, there's no time. It's always the right time. When you admit you've got a problem, it's always the right time. But it would be one thing if it was 2009. He was the ace of the staff that was about to win the World Series. He's not even pitching tonight. And truth is, if Tanaka doesn't beat Houston, the season's over.
Yeah. I have, like, mixed feelings about this whole wild card setup. You know, if you look over in the National League, you've got the Cubs and the Pirates, and they're probably two of the three best teams in the league, and they've got to go do a do-or-die thing tonight. And then you've got the Yankees and the Astros, and neither of these teams seem playoff-worthy. But they're in it. One of them is going to advance to Championship Series, the Division Championship Series, so the ALDS, as they would call it.
Right.
But CeCe wasn't going to pitch anyway. But
correct.
I will say this, he's looked pretty good lately. I mean, he tossed five pretty impressive innings against the Red Sox on Thursday, and, right after that, he started tossing down the drinks, and he didn't stop for 4 days.
Oh, boy. Yeah, that's I hope he's going to be okay. So on the way out, John, where are you right now? Midtown Manhattan, where are you exactly?
I'm in Lower Manhattan.
Lower Manhattan.
Right now.
Okay. So
I'm getting ready. Believe it or not, thinning hair, expanding waistline, and all. I have a TV shoot to do.
Good for you. Well, listen, then I'll let you run, but quickly on the way out. We're both Giant fans, and we're looking good, by the way, inside that division.
Yeah.
Very good. But in terms of the baseball, we know that New York is a Yankee town, right? We always talk about that. Yankees have one playoff game tonight. They hope to win to take on Kansas City on Thursday. The Mets start a big series against the Dodgers on Saturday. Right now, New York City is more pumped up over the Yanks or the Mets?
Oh, the Mets. The Mets. No, and not because I'm a Mets fan, but absolutely. Because it's been so long, because they've been the better team, you know, for the last couple of months. They've generated all the juice in town, where it seems as if the Yankees have just, you know, been hanging on to get into October. The Mets roared in. You know, they stumbled a bit at the end, but those games didn't matter much. The thing that irks me, and if the commissioner of Major League Baseball listens to your show when he's in Miami, right, which I'm sure he does.
Of course.
I mean, 9:45 on Friday night. I mean, are you ever going to get a little kid interested in baseball again?
No. That's awful. God, that
horrible.
Is awful.
Just horrible.
Yeah,
just
my six,
horrible.
My 7-year-old son can't even watch. You're 100% right.
Yes.
Hey, you know I love you. I think you're the best.
Yes.
And you are in New York. When I swear, hey, John, it's not Mike Francesa. It's not Imus. When I think of New York, I think of John Montone. So thank you again today.
You got it, Sid.
You're the
Be
best.
Well.
Take care. You
Take
too.
Care.
That is the great John Montone, because if news breaks out of New York City.
All news, all the time. This is 1010 Wins. You give us 22 minutes, we'll give you the word.
That's where you go. And I worked there, too. Hard to believe, but on my resume, and none of these, right now, obviously, WABC, WFAN, and 1010 Wins. John Montone with the latest on the tragic death, if not the irresponsible and horrible death, of the lady on Long Island who died in Chelsea, and, of course, the latest with CC Sabathia. We'll take a short break. Still lots more to do. Tom Verducci, one of the most popular and best baseball writers in the country. He's works for CNN, SI. He's also on the MLB Network and Fox. The Yankees and Astros later on tonight. The Cubs and Pirates, the one-game NL wild card, takes place tomorrow night. And then all your big series. The Royals will take on the winner of the Astros-Yankees. The Blue Jays take on the Texas Rangers. The Mets play the Dodgers. And the Cardinals take on the winner of the Cubs-Pirates game tomorrow night. All that great baseball about to come your way. We'll talk to Tom Verducci coming up at 8 from Politico, the latest on the rift between Jeb Bush and Marco Rubio. Mark Caputo will be here. Andrew Abramson on the Joe Philbin firing by the Miami Dolphins from the Palm Beach Post. He's going to stop by. And Mark Feinsand, more Yankee baseball. So a big show coming up, 844-640-6464. A very short break, and we're back right after this.
Live now. It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Astros, almost naivete plays here. They're so young. They're going to a Yankee Stadium that's the new Yankee Stadium. It's not the old one. And they get Dallas Keuchel, who could win the Cy Young, on the mound. It feels like they got a lot of the momentum going into this thing, plus the fact that Keuchel hasn't given up a run in a couple of starts against the Yankees this summer. So as we look to the fall here, they have the advantage?
I think they do with Keuchel, because 16 innings, no runs, one walk, 21 strikeouts. But he is pitching on short rest, which he's never done before. We never know about guys on short rest, how they do. Plus, Masahiro Tanaka has had a pretty good year for a guy who's been up and down. Still has a whip of 0.99. The league's hitting 221 against him, which suggests when he's right, he's a hard guy to hit.
And Astros tonight, of course, Yankee fans know the all-time great Mariano Rivera would enter the game to this song, Enter the Sandman, Metallica. See right now, Good Morning America, what story they're running. Police investigate doctor's mysterious death. Mother of three found dead in a doorway. We've covered that twice already today, once with world-renowned family therapist and sex therapist Liz Mandel, and then John Montone, 1010 Wins. We'll get back to that story, but it is baseball time. The Yanks will host the Astros tonight in a winner-take-all. The winner starts the five-game ALDS in Kansas City against the Royals on Thursday. Tonight's loser goes home. Nobody better to talk baseball with than my good friend from CNN, SI, MLB Network, and Fox, Tom Verducci. Good morning, Tommy. How are you, pal?
Real good. How you doing?
I'm doing good. I'll tell you a funny story. I know you were on the network last night. Back in 99, Tommy, before I got my first chance at WNEW and WFAN in New York, I got a phone call from my agent. And he said, listen, Sporting News, at the time they still had radio, Sporting News wants you to do a baseball show from the old, it's now out of business, Mickey Mantle's restaurant on Fifth Avenue. And they want you to co-host with a guy named Brian Kilmeade. And I'm like, who the hell is that? No way am I doing that. That was 1999. Yeah. Now, 16 years later, he's on Fox and Friends and hanging out with you on the MLB Network.
Turned out pretty good for Brian. Not as good for Mickey Mantle.
I tell you what, it was funny watching the four of you last night. At one point, you guys actually broke into a little Donald Trump political conversation. How about that?
I know. Well, that was bound to happen with Brian there. But as you know, he's a huge sports fan, started in the business, as you know, in sports. And I did not know that he and Brian Kenny, two Brians, are both from Massapequa, Long Island.
Yes, they are.
They were telling some stories.
That's a great town, by the way. I used to go to that town quite a bit, the Busy Bee Flea Market there, right off of Sunrise. Hey, tell me this, Tommy. I know the Yankees are getting ready to play Houston, but the big story in and around the Yankees is CC Sabathia came out after a horrid weekend in Baltimore, admitted he's got a bad problem, which I give him credit for, a courageous act, I thought, on his part. He's going to rehab, and that's kind of the big story for the Yankees today. Came out of nowhere. How about the CC Sabathia story?
Well, you're right. You do have to give him a lot of credit for coming out, because I think the Yankees were willing to offer him an out where you can just say, hey, some personal issues I have to deal with, I have to leave the team. But he said, no, I'm going to be upfront with this. I'm going to be transparent. As you know, it's part of what people need to do to get to work through this disease is to be completely honest with yourself. And what it tells me is that he reached an obvious point of urgency, maybe a breaking point, if you want to call that. If you read his statement, the first thing he talked about is how much it pains him because of the timing of this on the eve of the playoffs. So, you know, he talked also about his family, of course. So it tells me that he did reach a point where, unless we always say this, that baseball is second to what's going on in your life and your family. But he reached a point where there was no ignoring that fact, that there was urgency to addressing the issue.
And how about the New York fans that are convinced there's something much more sinister at play here, that maybe he got in trouble, maybe there's something brewing that made him do this because the timing seems so suspect. To me, they sound very unsympathizing and really lousy, but there's a large portion of Yankee fans that think something a lot more sinister is going on.
Well, listen, I don't know how large this segment is, but in our society, there's going to be a segment of people who are conspiracy theorists or want to assume the worst or will read intentions into things that aren't there. I get that. And we tend to amplify the concerns of those people rather than focusing on the real issue that this guy needs help. And what's more important is that he went to the Yankees and said, guys, I can't pitch. I have to address this right away. And you heard it in Girardi's voice. The concern that the team itself has for Sabathia is beyond reproach. I mean, you know, he's one of the most popular players in that clubhouse.
He is, and has been that way since he arrived and won a World Series back in 2009. Let's get to the game tonight. There is nothing on paper, as good as Tanaka has been, that says the Yanks will have any success against Dallas Keuchel, unless you're buying into the old short rest here. Maybe the short rest, maybe that'll come back to bite Houston, but really, is there any logical reason to think the Yanks are going to win this game tonight?
No, I don't think the 3 days rest. I don't think the 3 days rest thing is huge. I mean, I get it. He's never done it before, and it makes for a nice storyline going into it. But you know, ask Jack McKinnon and Josh Beckett how that worked out
right
into the old
right
Yankee Stadium. Right. You know, it's only an issue if the guy doesn't pitch well, and then that people will say that's the reason he didn't pitch well. I mean, listen, the Yankees in the last 2 months without Teixeira have been brutal against left-handed pitching. And they're 8-12 in the last 2 months of the season when they see a lefty. And this guy's not just any lefty. He's a guy who keeps the ball down. And the Yankees' best asset is the home run ball, especially at home in the short porch. Well, he takes that away with the way that he pitches. So I think he'll pitch well. I think Tanaka will pitch well. My only concern with Tanaka would be, you know, when he's not really sharp, he gives up home runs. His fastball is as straight as an arrow. If he hangs a split with that lineup, and all it takes is one or two mistakes. So, yeah, on paper, I think the Astros going in have an edge as the road team.
Then let's talk about the game coming up tomorrow night. The Pirates were the hottest team in baseball for practically the last 6 weeks, except for the last week and a half where the Cubbies ran off about 7 or 8 straight wins. None of that means anything to me because just so happens a couple Sundays ago when the Broncos were playing the Lions, I shut off the NFL game to watch the Cubs and Pirates because I had to watch Jake Arrieta. And listen, I watched Pedro and Gooden and Clemens and all these dominant pitchers. What I saw this year since July from Jake Arrieta is with all of them. So as good as Cole is and as good as the Pirates are, I don't see Jake Arrieta losing.
I agree with you. And I love the Pirates team, by the way. I think they're good enough to win the World Series. They just start out with the worst draw of anybody in the postseason, and that's getting Jake Arrieta in a winner-go-home game. I mean, he's been that good. I mean, sometimes it looks like the baseball that he's throwing is not round because it does weird things through the air. Wow. It moves so much. So you're talking about a team that has seen him 5 times this year. They're hitting 151 off Arrieta. You know, 3 extra base hits. They did sneak out a win back in May. They had a bloop double and a bloop single, and it was 1-0 when he left the game. They won 3-0. That's the only way they can win the game, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Is Cole has to go out there, pitch him 0-for-0, and scratch something out. But I'm with you. I think Arrieta right now is on one of these all-time historic roles, and he's just completely owned the Pirates all year long.
See, as I've gotten older, I care less about tradition. I'm one of those guys, Tommy, that wants to amend the Bible. I want to amend the Constitution. So I'm okay with the second wild card. I really do. I'm okay with it. I enjoy it. But, in a year like this, when you statistically, just by wins and losses, the Cubs and Pirates are 2 of the best 3 teams in baseball, and the Pirates may be the best team in baseball, it does seem kind of unfair that one of these teams will be gone after tomorrow night.
Yes and no. I get it on paper, but we're always trying to find, you know, the most fair schedule. Baseball is not played in a vacuum. The schedule will never be fair. And I'll tell you, people can keep whining about this, Sid. It's never going to change, and I'll tell you why. There aren't too many games right now in the postseason that are non-clinching games, non-decisive games. You cannot add more of those games to the postseason calendar, and you can't add more days to the postseason calendar. So if you win your division like the Cardinals, and you say, well, it's not fair to go one win or go home game, and so you're going to play best out of 3 or best out of 5, you're going to make that team that won a division sit around for a week.
Yeah,
and in baseball, that's a penalty. You're penalizing a team that was better over 162.
That's true.
So it's never going to change, and people are going to whine about it every year. There's a simple solution to this. Win your division. Stay out of that game.
Good point, Tom. Tom Verducci, CNN, SI, MLB Network, and Fox. So Cubs and Pirates taking on a Cardinal team that one of them, a Cardinal team that was the only 100-win club in baseball this year. They started out the gate at a horse race like Secretariat. They never looked back. With that said, are they vulnerable against either Chicago or Pittsburgh?
Yeah, they are, and I'll tell you why. I know with all the injuries they've had, it's been incredible the way they withstood them, but Yadi Molina is the most indispensable player, and these next couple of days they're gonna fit his left hand, a thumb with the ligament in it, with a splint. He's going to see if he can catch and bat with a splint on his thumb. It sounds like he's going to try to give it a go, but if he's compromised, I don't think they can win. I think he's that important to this team. You know, also the Carlos Martinez injury was big because I thought he had shut down stuff where he can go out there and win a postseason game on his own. So I don't think they're at full strength. Again, they haven't been all year. I'm very impressed with the way they just plug and play these kids for the minor leagues and they don't miss a beat. But I think the injuries may catch up with them in a 5-game series.
My Mets, this is rough. They really blew it down the stretch. They were horrendous offensively, including Cespedes, and they blew the home field against the Dodgers. And I know they had success in Los Angeles, Tommy, in a series a couple of months ago, and they did okay against both Kershaw and Greinke. But I don't know, facing those guys in L.A., DeGrom will start on Friday. The way the Met offense closed down the stretch, I was excited about the Mets about 3 weeks ago. Now I'm very, very nervous.
You should be. Yeah, no question. I mean, listen, at home with Greinke and with Kershaw, they're 12-1 in the second half of the season. I think it's 23-8 on the season. Syndergaard pitches much better at home than on the road, and he's pitching in Dodger Stadium. I just believe this. Clayton Kershaw is the best pitcher on the planet. You know, he's proved that year after year after year. He's not going to keep having a 5.12 ERA in the postseason. This guy is due to pitch a gem in the postseason, especially at home. So you make a hit with a left hook from Kershaw in game one. Then you got Syndergaard on the road. I guess, you know, one thing, the way it turns out, I know you wanted Matt Harvey to pitch twice, but right, having him sitting there for a game three, which is always pivotal, at home against Brett Anderson or Alex Wood, you got to like those chances there. But I just think it's too much seeing those two big dudes, Kershaw and Greinke, in a series where you know Kershaw is going to come back and pitch on short rest, even if they're up. Mattingly's done that before.
Agreed. Last one, we'll let you run. Toronto, Texas, interesting matchup. I think most people think the Blue Jays are the class of the American League, but once they got Cole Hamels, and not necessarily because of Cole Hamels, Texas went on a run and took over the AL West. What about that series?
Yeah, it's a fascinating series because I think it's kind of old school. I think you'll see a lot of runs scored, long games, pitching changes. But here's the thing about Toronto for me. They remind me of Kansas City last year. The place is absolutely crazy. It's a huge home field advantage. You better get that team on its heels early because the more they win, especially the more they win at home, and you saw this last year with Kansas City going 8-0, so the tougher they are to beat. Now, Cole Hamels is the one pitcher, I think, who's got the profile to beat them. You know, when they've had trouble, you know, the kid Morgan from Philadelphia beat them twice. It's been soft-throwing lefties. Now, Hamels doesn't throw soft, but he's got that changeup from the left side to neutralize those big, powerful right-handed hitters. So to me, if Texas wins this series, it'll be Hamels in game two and game five pitching lights out. To me, that's the one way Texas can win the series. But I wouldn't go against Toronto. That line is just too good.
Yeah, me either. They are way too good. And you're too good. You're great. And I think we're in store for a very, very exciting baseball postseason, Tommy. And hopefully you'll come back a couple of times because, you know, I love you. Thank you, Tommy. Great stuff this morning.
Sounds good. Great time of year. Enjoy it.
Yeah, you too. There's no question about it. These baseball playoffs are going to be really good. I mean, I know it's week 4 or 5 of the NFL season. I mean, really, who cares? I mean, honestly. The Dolphins just fired their head coach. We're going to cover that as we have the last couple of days. Joe Philbin is out. Dan Campbell is in. But you're in store for great playoffs. Again, the Astros and Yankees tonight from the Bronx. The winner starts their 5-game best of 5 against Kansas City on the road on Thursday. Cubs and Pirates from Pittsburgh tomorrow. The winner of that starts their best of 5 in St. Louis on Friday. Rangers and Blue Jays start on Thursday. Mets and Dodgers start on Friday. Going to be an unbelievable baseball postseason. 844-640-6464. Already an amazing show. Liz Mandel, John Montone, Tommy Verducci, and two or three more big-name guests still to come your way. Back on a very busy Tuesday right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
Hi, I'm Dan Marino from the Miami Dolphins. Tonight, you'll get a chance to be my backup quarterback for a day. You'll get round-trip airfare and tickets to a game, a complete uniform, and a chance to meet me. Stay tuned. I'll have details on how to enter, and we'll be announcing a winner later tonight.
Okay, it's a little long, and I think you flubbed on that last.
Did not flub at all.
No, it wasn't a flub. It was no flub.
But, it was not a flub.
You want to see that playback?
No, come on. Let's do it.
Just a hair. Ready? Take 3, 25-second version. Action.
Hi, I'm Dan Marino from the Miami Dolphins. Tonight, you'll get a chance to be my backup quarterback for a day. You'll get round trip, airfare, and tickets to a game, a complete uniform, and a chance to meet me. Stay tuned. I'll have details on how to enter, and we'll be announcing a winner later tonight.
Perfect.
Send it in.
You want to see a playback on it?
Nope. I don't want to see shit.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
It was important today that we try to handle everything with as much respect and dignity as we could. And we had good conversations. Steve did. I did with Coach Philbin. And again, he gave us everything he had for 4 years. Obviously, things weren't going as well as we had hoped this year. Steve made the decision this morning, and then we moved forward accordingly. With that, I'd like to introduce Dan Campbell as our new interim head coach.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Mike. First things first with Coach Philbin, you know, I have the utmost respect for Joe. That being said, this is my 6th season with the Miami Dolphins, and this is the most talented roster that we have had in those 6 years. We have enough to win. We have to change the culture. I have to change the culture. We'll start there. I think we'll be in the right direction. I don't think, I know, that'll put us in the right direction. You know, I'm appreciative to Mr. Ross for the opportunity. You know, this is the 5th organization that I've been a part of, and nobody on those teams has
spent more on resources or has committed more to wanting to win than Mr. Ross. That, I mean, that is the fact. I mean, he'll do, and he told me when I talked to him earlier, he said, whatever you need, I'll be there for you. So whatever you think you need, whatever it takes to turn the team around, you've got it. So that's fortunate to have an owner that is that way. So and that's what I intend to do, and I'm appreciative for the support.
Something's in the air tonight. The sky's alive with the burning light. Come mark my words, something's about to break. I found myself in a bitter fight when I felt your hand through the darkest night. Don't know where you're coming from, but you're coming soon to a cure for Morgan. Way of California, all this more than I've ever known or seen. Come on and we'll see you like we were free. Push the pedal down, watch the world around fly by us. Come on and we'll try one last time. And here we go, there's nothing left to choose. And here we go, there's nothing left to lose.
Nothing left to lose, Matt Carney. Dan Campbell, former Giant and Dallas Cowboy, amongst other tight ends. Now the head coach of your Miami Dolphins. So Ross did the right thing. He fired Philbin. Joe had to go. We went over that extensively the last 2 weeks. Really, they never should have brought him back after last year. Adam Schefter talked about that on ESPN last night, that most Dolphin fans and people here thought he'd be gone after year three, after suffering his second consecutive December collapse. But they brought him back and gave him an extension for year four, and of course we know how it went, 1-3, a very unimpressive week one win over Washington, and then three really lousy efforts in losses to Jacksonville, Buffalo, and the Jets in London. So he's gone. Dan Campbell moves in. You also heard my good buddy Mike Tannenbaum at the very beginning there introducing Dan Campbell as the new interim head coach of the Dolphins. Although I've been told here that Mike Tannenbaum has given Dan Campbell the supreme authority, the ultimate authority, to fire both offensive coordinator Bill Lazor and or defensive coordinator Kevin Coyle. Not sure he will do either of those things, but he has been given the supreme authority to do that, to kind of reshape his own coaching staff, Dan Campbell, during a week four bye week before the Dolphins start week five in Tennessee against the Titans. But that's pretty ballsy, no?
Yeah, and he's got 2 weeks to think about it, so.
No, he doesn't. He's better think about it this
week.
Well,
I mean,
and make some changes and get ready for Tennessee with his new staff in place next week.
Right, so a week to think, a week, and then get ready.
I think it's funny when Dan goes, listen, I've got the utmost respect for Joe Philbin, but the culture here sucks. We have enough talent to win. This is the most talent we've had in 6 years. Well, how do you have the utmost respect for Joe Philbin, and the very next sentence you say, we've got the most talent we've had here in 6 years, and I need to change the culture? That goes directly back to the coach. I mean, think about that. It's basically he's trying to give the coach, say something nice about the coach, and crushed him 2 seconds later.
Yeah, but
changing the culture is about the coach. Think about that. The personnel, that's on Mike Tannenbaum. You know, if you're cheap or not,
right.
That's on Steve Ross. When you talk about culture, discipline, that's the coach. So I've got the utmost respect for Philbin, but he sucked. We've got a lot of talent, and the culture here blows, and thank God I took his place, is basically what Dan Campbell said.
But you can read into that because you're smart. A lot of the moronic people listening to that say, oh, yeah, they don't see it as a shot. They're like, oh yeah.
Huge shot.
But I agree with you 100%. It absolutely was.
Everybody hates Philbin. Everybody hates Kevin Coyle. The whole defense hates him, including Sue, who wore tennis sneakers to practice this week because he hates the two-gap defense. He hates him. Everybody hates Ryan Tannehill. Now the practice squad players are in a war with Ryan. Supposedly, he told them, enjoy those practice squad paychecks while I'm getting my $16 million. So your defensive coordinator is despised by the team. Your head coach was not really liked by the team. Your quarterback is now having issues. And all that's going on in and around Joe Philbin. And Dan Campbell, of course, pointed that out when he talked about the culture. Now, Armando Salguero wrote in today's Miami Herald, absentee owner Stephen Ross is at the root of the Dolphins' problem. He had a very big problem with Stephen Ross firing Joe Philbin over the phone. Kind of like what Liz Mandel talked about this morning. When you break up with somebody over the phone, you just don't do that, you know. So when you drive over and you break up. And so he had a big problem with that Steve Ross is basically in New York. He's not here. And he fired Philbin over the phone, and he describes him as an absentee owner, and that's a big issue. That according to Armando Salguero. See, me, it doesn't matter. The less of the owner around, the better. As long as he spends money, you hope he spends it wisely, but that's not on Stephen Ross. That's on Mike Tannenbaum and Pat Hickey and Joe Philbin and the rest of those folks. I just think the people in this town want to find somebody to blame, if not everybody to blame, for the Dolphins. Whether or not Stephen Ross is here or there, if he was not spending money, if he was a cheap owner, I mean, his issue is he does dumb things, spends too much money elsewhere, including stadium renovations and orange carpets. But I don't know. I think the whole Steve Ross thing is overplayed in this town. I really do. We got to take a short break, and we'll get back to the Philbin talk, Yankees and Astros, later on tonight. But Mark Caputo does a very good job of covering local politics. You can read his Florida playbook on Politico.com. Each and every week he updates it. So we'll talk about local and national politics with Mark Caputo of Politico right after this.